Blow the whistle, coming back at you. I'm your host, D. Brown. Got your co-host over here, Dame, not your average therapist, is in the building as always. Blow the whistle, interactive podcast. We're bringing sports and mental health together. Blow the whistle. Blow the whistle. Make sure you like and follow Blow the Whistle _ on Instagram, Blow the Whistle on Facebook. Subscribe to our YouTube Blow the Whistle channel. Make sure you check out all the highlights, all the bloopers. We got some stuff, y'all.
You want the shirt? You see the shirt? You want the shirt?
It's gonna live out there for you.
Exactly for you. Blow the whistle.
Hey man, we here.
Blow the whistle.
Better.
What's up, man?
What?
What's going on? This is Sean Foster in the building, ladies and gentlemen. Blow the whistle.
Blow the whistle on Sean Foster.
Yeah, man. I love it. I love it. Good to have you. Good to have you. Definitely.
Bro, like the artwork.
I was just
I like the artwork.
Huh? Go ahead.
I like the artwork behind y'all.
Oh, appreciate it, man. Yeah, definitely shout out to Puro Collections on IG. Check them out. You got some funky paintings that he does. You know what I'm saying? Freehand. Been knowing this guy since high school.
Bad,
for real.
Bad, yeah. He's a good painter.
Man, I was giving an intro to the viewers before, so I'm gonna skim through what I said now. Now if I skip anything, again, tell me, because you know I want to blow you up as much as possible. Second pick in the second round. Basically, that's a first. That to me, that's a first round pick.
Okay.
2002 Carolina Panthers, right? Bam. Yeah. Number four, number five all time UCLA and Russian. Yeah. Number two in touchdown, number two in single game total yards, right?
Yeah.
Number four at Carolina Panthers all-time leading rusher. Number four, that's the last.
Man, I really think it's top five.
I really think it's three because Cam Newton, one of them, that don't count.
Yeah,
that's right. That don't count.
You got a quarterback in there, you know, that don't count, okay? But right. We're in the top. We're definitely in the top three, top four. Panthers all time. Would you say one? You know, don't brag on yourself. We got a chance to brag on yourself. Would you say one of the dopest Super Bowl runs in Super Bowl history?
Man.
Yeah. Going back on it now, at the time, you know, you can't talk about yourself like that. But now, it's been over a decade.
Yeah, you got a platform now. Yeah,
you feel me?
We just reminiscing.
That's it. Like you. But yeah, it was you know what I'm saying? It was just that was a moment. You know what I mean? It's just being there, making it to the Super Bowl, just the situation that it was in, you know, just getting an opportunity to get a carry, you know, with Big Dog in there, we didn't get many carries and stuff, being the type of back that he was. So I was just excited I was able to make something happen and get to the zone.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, talking about that, let's talk about one of your own favorite moments that you've had, either that be high school, college, NFL career, or post-career. What would you say is like one of your favorite moments?
It's probably gonna have to be that Super Bowl run or just playing in the Super Bowl. You know what I'm saying? Just knowing that we was one of the two best teams in the world at that time. You know, everybody was watching that game. Beyonce sang the national anthem. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was a big game. That was the Janet Jackson.
Right.
You know? And so it was a huge game just being in that moment and be able to capitalize. You know, we didn't get the victory and everything, but so it would have been.
That
really
was the Janet Jackson reveal? The snatch up? Oh.
Ooh.
You say that, everybody know exactly
what's your malfunction.
Right.
What's your malfunction?
Yep, exactly.
So, man, you're at UCLA now. You're back at your alma mater. You had a first stint there, then went on to Texas Tech for a little bit and got to see Patrick Mahomes. I just thought about that, so I'm gonna ask you about that cat real quick. But then you had an opportunity to go back to your alma mater, an all-time great, and now you know you're coaching the running backs over at UCLA now under Coach Kelly, right?
Yeah.
Let's get back to Mr. MVP. You know, you had a chance to see it up close before anybody could see it. You got to see it develop. The man has even said, "Listen, I just started learning how to read defenses just, you know, a couple years ago."
Right.
What was that like watching a kid like this who's like, you know, man, he's setting marks that's unprecedented.
Coming from UCLA, we had Josh Rosen. So I left, and it was Josh's freshman or sophomore season. Was it his freshman season? He had just played well as a freshman. So I'm seeing it as a freshman. I was like, man, this guy's pretty good, right? Yeah. I get to Texas Tech, have no idea. Mm. I knew that they threw the ball, but I didn't know the talent of the quarterback. You know what I mean? So when we get there, I get there in spring.
Yeah.
And just seeing some of the stuff that he was doing, it was real Aaron Rodgers-like. You know what I'm saying? Just the arm talent.
Wow.
And just to see how the guys rally behind him. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, Dee, you play a quarterback, so you know when you get everybody, they truly believe in you no matter what's going on. Yeah. We down 20 and they still out there playing. You know what I mean? So it was an amazing year just being around that. We was the number one offense that year. That was a game when we played Oklahoma. I think Pat had like 700 yards.
Yeah.
But Pat was it's not just an arm talent. It's the kid can just extend plays. He might not necessarily run, but it's just the way he can extend plays, just keep the drive going, and guys rally behind him. And, you know, if you can get the guys to rally behind you, that's huge at quarterback position.
So you saw that. So what they see now in the little highlights when he's talking to the cats on the sideline, talking to his line, you know, rallying everybody up, you know, the infamous, you know, all the rally that he was doing against the Texans, but he's doing that throughout the whole year. You've seen that. He's been doing that. That's just part of his character, who he is.
Yeah, exactly. That's just who he is. I was seeing that from spring all the way through to the last game of the season.
Wow.
Being able to see him and having that to be able to carry over.
Yeah.
You know? Well,
yeah.
The sky's the limit for a young man, you know?
Absolutely. 24 years old?
Mm-hmm.
Man, he has a long way to go. Just stay healthy, and I think he's going to rewrite some record books. Yeah.
So talking about him, just recently they just put out like a commercial that he kind of spearheaded, you know, in the Black Lives Matter commercial. So what do you feel like currently, what's the climate as far as coaching in the college ranks as well as being in the NFL? What do you think the climate, or how do you feel like the climate is right now going on with the Black protest, what's going on in society as far as the pandemic and how they all dealing with that within the locker room?
I mean, it was just good that Pat was able to get out there and let him know, let the world know how he's feeling. Just being that the top four quarterbacks in the NFL are Black,
right?
You know what I mean? So this isn't the old times or just how the NFL used to operate or what was going on. You know, the top four are Black and they're playing at a very high level. So it's just good that they're able to voice their opinion and let the world know that, you know, these, if they're not playing football, they could be just like every other man that's out here getting murdered or any situation. So I'm just glad the guys are able to take this, their platform and use it for good. You know, it's just, we got to get that conversation out. Just the number one thing is communicate. We got to be able to talk this out and let them hear us. And so we can hear them and understand maybe why they don't understand or maybe they need to understand why we are so passionate about what we're saying.
Exactly.
And so it's just good that, you know, for me, being a coach, you know, coaching at UCLA, being a running back coach, you know, a lot of the running backs look like me. So I just try to make sure I'm a role model for them and let them talk things out and give them an opportunity to speak, you know, because these young guys, they really are aware of what's going on in the world. You know, it's when we was playing football, it was a little bit different, you know.
I was gonna ask you, and kind of, I'm glad you kind of said that because we're gonna segue into that piece. Mm-hmm. You're now, you know, you played in the generation, you know, when we played, but now you're also coaching in an entire different generation. And like as you were about to say, it's totally different from when you say student athlete when we were one, and when now that the ones that you're coaching and monitoring and governing. It's a totally different perspective. It's a totally different outlook where I look, and you can add on to this, back when we was coming up, our eyes were trained and we were conditioned just focus on the task, you know, being the best at, you know, that type of stuff was around us, but it wasn't near us. These guys are, it still might not necessarily be around them, but they're pushing themselves to be near it.
Out to it, exactly.
Yeah, they're reaching out to be near it. Right. You know, where we were, you know, not so conditioned to do the same thing. How do you see the difference in the student athletes balancing that those two worlds, I guess you could say. Yeah.
This is really going to be the true test this season, you know, just seeing how guys being able to be as vocal as they are now, just being able to handle football and still be passionate about what's going on. You know, the NBA is really going to show us how that's going to happen, you know, in their bubble, and some guys didn't want to play and some guys did. So we're going to see how, if they can still use their platform and keep the momentum that we have going, you know. So it's just, as long as they can stay focused, then everything should be okay. Just keep the task at hand. You know what I mean? Understand what you're doing and what you're saying, and don't just go out there and retweet something unless you read about it, or, you know what I mean? That's a lot of things that I try to tell my guys. Make sure you read something before you retweet it. Do a little bit of homework before you're just jumping out and stuff, because you can't go back on stuff. You know what I mean? So that's huge.
It's out there.
Yeah. Exactly. Once it's out there, it's out there. You can delete it, but somebody saw it.
Right.
So, you know, just be aware of what you're saying, and, you know, just think things out. You know, you can't muzzle these guys. You can't mute them. You know, you just got to educate them and make sure that they know what they're saying, and saying the right things.
And it's interesting you said it, man, because we're so sensationalized this day and age. But you said to look at, you know, kind of look at and do your homework first. And it's just, how do you tell an 18, 19, 20-year-old to kind of bounce, you know what I mean, to kind of make that type of grown-up discretion?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because
you don't know what balance is. That
you got to learn from that. You got to learn from that experience. Yeah. So we didn't have to deal with that. But how do they? I don't know. How do they do that? You know what I'm saying? And the whole mental aspect. You say stay focused, and it's like, okay, well, break it off into a pie chart. How do I stay focused on ball, school, what's happening around me 24 hours a day? I got my whole social life. Maybe a little bit of family. Maybe a little bit of something. Right. You know what I'm saying? Something else. You know, just wow. It's interesting you had said that about the focus piece, because focus, the definition of focus has changed so much for this generation.
Yes. But they're able to multitask a little bit better than prior generations.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because just like you said, we were always focused on one thing, like this is what you're doing.
Right.
You know, they understand that they have a little bit more of a voice and that they can do a little bit more. And that's starting more in high school than even now. Once they get in college, you know what I'm saying? So just like you said, they're reaching out for certain stuff. Like they're trying to, let me get this information. Let me see what this is about. This is about, but it's just good that they're able to see professionals do it. And then now they can try to tailor their life.
So to add on to that, and to kind of just maybe jump to this particular aspect, as a therapist, I kind of see student athletes, students, you know, all types of climates, and especially within athletes in college and in high school, they start to struggle mentally trying to find that balance and understand, you know, what their purpose is, what their strengths are, and all those things. And then they start to, you know, maybe decline in a sense, whether that's their self-esteem, just their feelings of enjoyment and actually finding their passion. But some people just get stuck. So my question is, I know I just went on a rant, but my question is, how as a coach, how can you be an advocate for like mental health awareness, making sure that these student athletes know that they can come talk to you or at least ask for help? You know, with you being a coach, how is that kind of working in your role? Or would you label that as one of your roles?
No, that's one of your roles, because you're responsible for these kids. So that's on and off the field. You know what I mean? So with me, it's just, they all know I have an open door policy, like just come in here and talk to me. So it's more of befriending them, you know what I mean? So, and not just one of their homeboys, because I'm still going to discipline you and if something's wrong, but it's more of befriend that you can come talk to me no matter what, you know? So just a couple situations, just even if something's happening, it's out of position and it's not just my guys know on the team that they can come and talk to me about it, you know what I mean? Just being a coach that has played, I just know that there's more than just football going on in their lives.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, definitely. Oh, please say that line. Just a little bit louder.
Exactly.
People need to hear that one.
Exactly. I know that there's more than football going on in their lives. You know what I'm saying? So you got to take that in consideration. They got finals. They got a girlfriend. They have family. They're away from family.
Right.
That's the first time. Some of these guys, you know what I'm saying? So you just got to – you got. It's a constant – it's not just I'm talking to these guys during football season. This is a constant communication that we have going on. Right. You know what I mean? Like how me and you text D, that's how I text that group chat. Like we're constantly talking. You know, if I see something, hey, guys, you see this? Just something funny, okay. Then you just to open the line of communication to let them right. really know you can come and talk to me no matter what.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's just as a coach, I fully feel like I'm fully responsible for them on and off the field and their mental health. So you know what I mean? Because football can also trigger their mental health. You know what I mean? And one of the biggest signs that I have in my room is it's not the performer, it's the performance. Ooh. So don't think I'm getting on you. It's what you're doing. That's
Boy, you know I'm gonna take it. I'm gonna bite it. Say one more time, please.
That's real right there.
One more. I'm gonna put it down.
Right, it's not the performer; it's the performance.
Wow.
You know, I'm not getting on you. It's what you're doing.
Right.
You know, because and that just goes into like if you say something to somebody that could trigger them into getting into a hole in mental health or. Mm-hmm. Now they might not want to talk or he's shy. And, you know what I mean? So it's just, I just try to have a family atmosphere. That's the number one thing. It's a family atmosphere in there so we all can talk. You know what I mean? We're all brothers in there. We just got to all be able to communicate. And guys got to be able to learn from each other. That's the number one thing. We got to be able to learn from somebody else's mistake. It shouldn't have to hit you for you to understand that.
Right.
And man, I sit here and I listen to you and as I'm listening to you, my mind is going from, okay, you're a coach, mm-hmm. but there's other people in just everyday life. Like mm-hmm. a parent is the same as a coach, can do the same thing. A CEO or a executive or a manager of can you know, look at what has a team or they can look in and ask for the same things from their so-called players. You know what I mean? Like that's the same outlook and how much production that a business, you right. know, how much production that your own household,
yeah.
how much production a team rather would have when you have more people like that who take on that type of coach mentality. Yeah. And I always say, you know, that's one thing you can call anybody mom. Everybody look around. You can call anybody pa. You know, everybody cook. What's up, fam? This, right. that, and third. But you can't call everybody a coach.
That's true.
And sometimes that's just kind of an example of what mm-hmm. I'm talking about, how right. that role and just that outlook you can take off the field and put it in life and then even more intimately in your own household
right.
and man get a better outcome, I think. That's mm-hmm. that's crazy. Let's talk about the accidental dependence on the mask and the opiates to perform. And that's like we're talking about we've been sensationalized to mask pain.
Mm-hmm.
To reduce all signs of stress.
Right.
And by doing that and having that mentality, we make these unhealthy, when you think about it, unhealthy choices.
Yes.
And like I said, man, it's accidental. A lot of athletes, you just popping the pill. You ain't trying to, I'm trying to get woozy.
Right.
No, I'm trying to just max the pain so I can go perform. You know what I'm saying? How have you seen that as a player and a coach? Have you seen that trend elevate, or has it kind of been kind of what you've seen all along, just as a player transition coach?
It's more. I think it's different than when we was playing. You know what I mean? Because there was nothing for mental health, unless you were doing it on your own,
right?
You know what I mean? Like now there's so many just different avenues for them, you know?
Yeah.
We have CAPS, we have our own team doctor that they can talk to. Me as a position coach, my assistant, another coach on the staff, trainers, you know what I mean? Like there's just so many people that you can talk to and so many people are aware of it now. So when you see somebody acting out of character, it's more of a red flag now.
Yes.
Wow, we both played with somebody that we saw out of character a little bit and we weren't seeing anything right. being with it. Wow. I ain't gonna say nothing, but you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. It's different now. Like, if you see a red flag now, people are addressing that. And the kids are going through a little bit more now at a younger age, because with this following these Instagrams and these social medias and stuff, like, they're becoming famous without really doing anything to be famous.
Right? Man.
I mean,
wow. Yeah.
So now when they get to college and they're not getting that playing time and people are coming at them, they're not knowing how to handle this.
Right.
And this isn't a pressure that we were getting at this age. This is a pressure we were getting once we got to the NFL.
That's right.
They're getting this.
That's right.
Five, 6 years early.
I just saw an eighth grader made a big IG announcement about where he was transferring to. You know, and it was like, what, you just going?
I mean, like, yeah.
You just going to the ninth grade. I mean, he's a good basketball player, but it was that big of a LeBron, my decision type thing. It's like, man, you famous. Well, as we presume it to be to this day and age, we're famous. Like you said, we wasn't having that type of pressure or intention until we got to where it was well-deserved. Like, right now, this is not even deserved. Like, wow.
You know, and it's difficult for them to process that type of stuff because they're still developing mentally.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So my question is, would you say that you would be like a huge proponent to have, let's say, like therapists at each, each sporting like department?
Facility.
The facility, as far as whether it's football, basketball, I envision with the awareness of mental health and what's been going on in the climate lately, that there's a necessity for each and every school to have a therapist on staff, just for those departments.
Yeah. I would think.
Yeah. Because we basically have CAPS, and that's a department that's already on campus.
Okay.
They can go directly there. You know what I mean? Like, there's no, and it's not a, because you have to remember too, they don't want to have people seeing them doing this.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to get labeled that now I need this or something like that. So it's a real discreet. I just like how it's set up, and it's I'm just glad because it's a filter that's able to catch, and we can help players. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. When we're playing, you might fall through the cracks and we don't understand how you got into this funk, not knowing that it had nothing to do with football. You know?
Wow.
So it's just good that we're able to, you know, just the channels that we have and just the processes and just how things are laid out. We're able to diagnose and find a little bit more things. And even with the high school eval, just talking to the kid more, you know, just finding, talking to, you know what I mean? So it's helped all the way because it's getting earlier. We're finding this out earlier in high school and stuff like that. So, you know, I think most of the colleges probably do have somebody in the building. It's more of now we need to get high schools to have somebody in the building. Mm. You know what I mean? Because if you really think, like, but they just showed the guy that's going to Michigan State, he's a sophomore. He's the best player in the Monty Bates kid, if he goes plays, he's the best player. If he goes to the draft right now, they said he'd be the first pick.
Wow.
He's 16. Wow. That's a 16-year-old. You know what I mean? That's a lot of pressure on somebody that's 16. Think about when you were 16. I just wanted to start. I wasn't worried. You know what I mean? Like,
I just wanted to start.
I wanted to play varsity and start. That's
yeah. I'm proud of a while. My mama.
That's it. That's it, man. I just wanted to go to the pizza place and people act like they knew me. That's all I wanted to do.
I want a million followers for life.
But it's a different, you know what I mean? And with this day and age, it comes with that pressure. But it's just good that everything, like, you know, it's just being brought up. The more we can talk about it, it's everything. The more we can talk about it. Mental health.
Right.
You know what I mean? Just every situation that's going on, anything that's going on, as long as we can communicate and bring it up and have these subjects and these talks, it can help.
Yeah, man, I saw you, you know, you said two things that were great. Like you said, one of the things that you have an open door policy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Again, that's one of the other things I was saying, and just being in a leadership position to have that, and have that to be known, because everybody doesn't have that. Every leader doesn't have that. So someone to keep the door closed and keep the shades closed. You know what I'm saying? You got to knock. You got to call the secretary and get a meeting. You know, like, you know, that's it. Like, but to have that open door, man, gives that comfort. You know, like you say, to have that text message, you know what I'm saying? Some they may not tell you, but they depend on that reach out. You know what I'm saying? Oh, yeah. You know, just absolutely. That, you know, even if they don't touch back, they depend on that reach out. So you just said some things, man, that you guys are already doing. You know, say like you said, it's a you notice it's a red flag now. Well, that's not how you grew up, and that's hard to do because a lot of us are just stuck in our ways, mm-hmm. and it's hard to transition and transform our minds to see that. But like you said, back then we masked our pain, mm-hmm. but now you know.
It's more,
you're more observant. Like you said, oh, that's a red flag. Yeah. This boy, he off the kilt right. He off the kilt right now. He on one. Something going on. You know, it ain't right. You know, right. He don't act like this normally. Like, you know, other times he just crazy. He pop funny. Yeah. It ain't funny no more.
Right. Exactly. It could turn into something that you just now we can't handle this.
Yeah.
It can snowball into something bad. So you can't. Right. You know.
Yeah,
you have to address it.
How do we navigate through that piece? How do you take your kids or prepare them? Because all of them ain't going to the draft. You know, it's going to be a last game for everyone. How do you value yourself as what your title is?
I always try to tell my guys, we all like a bottle of milk. We all gonna expire. You just don't know your expiration date. You know what I'm saying? Everybody's football comes to an end. Jerry Rice played 20 years. He'll be a regular person longer than he'll be a football player.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I'm saying? And he played 20.
Wow.
All right? You know what I mean? So a lot of people aren't gonna do that. You just gotta, so back to, okay. Now, I guess who I am now basically is just a mentor. You know what I mean? Just really, like you said, we lived out these kids' dream. Just they dream to want to go to the NFL and play running back, and we lived that out. So now I just try to give them the knowledge and how to go about things and just how to prepare, how to, you know what I mean? Just little things, how to carry themselves doing this, how to go do this, how to operate in this situation, how, you know what I mean? So just think about it. If you had somebody coaching you, and we had some really good coaches. I had some good coaches.
Yeah, we did.
But you know what I mean? Like, we had some good coaches. Because I had Jim Skipper in Carolina, and then I had his son at UCLA. You know, so. But just going back to, think about playing for somebody that had played in the NFL and did exactly what you did. You know what I mean? Even though we were prepared, there's just little things that you can find out. You know what I mean? Just take care of your body. I'm on top of them about taking care of their body right now.
Yeah.
You know, at this age, I thought I was invincible. I could go play a football game and it's nothing.
Yeah. But
I'm not knowing that my body is my car. Like, you know, the NASCAR drivers aren't just going out there just hitting their car up against everything and it's all good. Like, you know, so it was more of now, okay. Hey guys, take care of your body. Let's get everybody on a routine. We're getting a massage this day. We doing yoga this day. We doing this. You know what I'm saying? Right. And they listen because they're like, oh, this is what you were doing? Oh, okay, cool.
Right.
Now think about if we could have did that 5 years earlier.
That's right.
Mm. So it's more of just giving the knowledge that we had. But that's just who we were as people though. I wasn't, every year I was in Carolina, they drafted a running back. So I had to teach this joker the plays. But I'm not a guy that's not going to, you know what I mean? The best man's going to win. Like, I had somebody my first year that didn't teach me the plays.
Right.
And then the second year, we had somebody that taught us everything.
Right.
But that just shows you how comfortable that man was in his ability compared to another man in his ability. You know what I'm saying? So it's just always just try to teach somebody and give the knowledge that you have. That's basically what this whole movement should be about. You know what I'm saying? Like, we need to get in, we need to have the access that everybody else has access to.
Yes, absolutely.
You know what I mean? So if you have an opportunity that you can intern at this store, at this business, this company with these people, you know what I mean? To take that. And that's what I try to tell my friends that don't look like me. If you have an opportunity to give an internship to somebody or teach somebody or help them, then do that. You know, it's not giving out a free ride. Teach them the craft.
Right.
Teach them how you go about it.
Right.
That's change. That'll change things. You know what I'm saying? So that's just how I just try to teach these guys. Just and they're just smart. I just like that this new era of kids, they're just smart. You know, they're smart kids. They more aware of what's going on, social justice, everything. They're just aware of it. You know, so even if they're not even experiencing it, because I know a lot of my guys haven't experienced it, but they still understand what's going on. And I like that they're using their platform to say what they can and what they can't. So it's just, you know, hopefully we can just keep the momentum going, and, you know, hopefully, you know, college football will be able to come back and my guys will be able to play football and keep going.
So how do you feel about what's going on with, as far as like COVID-19 and the college football season, what they're trying to do, you know, for that? Because there's a lot of, yes, precautionary measures that need to take place if there's going to be any type of season. Speaking about just doing only conference games. So talk to us a little bit about what you feel like is going on with that.
And we just got to make sure
that
the guys are safe. You know, there can't be, they're student athletes, you know, they're student athletes. And you have to say that to yourself, just like that. They're student athletes. They're not athlete students. They're student athletes. So, you know, like I always tell my guys, it's books and ball. Books and ball. That's what we're here to do. But you got to make sure that we're going to put them in a situation that they're safe. You know, that's just the number one thing. You know, just they got to be safe. So just as for us, it's nothing that we can do. You know, ours is more of what California is going to do when the California opens up, when they say we can do this and what we can do that. Right now, we have voluntary work. We have a lot of guys there. I mean, voluntary workouts. A lot of guys are there working out. They're social distancing, staying away from each other, just getting ready for the season. So we just got to just continue to go like that. But we just have to make sure that we're putting the priority in how safe are these kids going to be going out there and playing.
Man, last plug for UCLA. If I had an audience of recruits, what type of guy do you guys want? Point blank period.
Just back to my word, I tell my guys, books and ball. Got to have somebody that's going to be ready to work in the classroom and work on the field. You know, you're going to be more than a football player.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, you're not here to major in football.
Wow.
You know, so that's just what I just try to tell my guys, you know, just get out and learn. If you want to, okay, I always use this as an example also with my guys. So we lift weights, right? We're going to be in that weight room lifting and getting strong so we can perform on a football field.
Yeah. Right.
So how are you elevating your mind? How are you fixing this muscle? What are we doing?
Yeah.
Right? Because all football starts coming down to, once you get to these higher levels, is who can critically think and who can function tired. You know what I'm saying? Ability isn't really the number one thing anymore. It starts getting down to situational stuff. Who can critically think, okay, I've been in this situation before. What happened? You know what I mean? Just so I try to tell my guys, you got to go to that classroom and you got to function over there to get this mind going. And now you start seeing football in a different way instead of just that same way you've been looking at it. But you got to develop this. Got to find a way to develop your mind. And it's not just go reading. You got to go in the classroom, speak, talk, interact with your classmates, with the professors, you know? So I'm just glad that, you know, my room's pretty smart. I think we had a little bit over a 3-0. So my guys can, you know, they can think on it.
Wouldn't expect anything less. I told you, right. Running backs are some of the smartest people on the field.
You tied to two groups. You tied with the quarterback and you tied with the line. And a lot of that stuff isn't communicated. You got to know the look and know what's going on. So, you know, I try to make sure I have some guys that can think. Right. So, anybody can just tote the rock.
So how do you get them to kind of understand the importance of, just like you said, working out, but also working your brain and being able to process things, but also being able to remove the negative things that may come about, whether that's negative thoughts, whether that's isolation or adjustment, you know, coming from home to now being in school, dealing with that emotional shift. How do you kind of advocate and talk to them about making sure they're doing the necessary things, you know, to make sure that they are able to stay focused and it's not cluttered with everything else that's outside of that bubble?
Just because of their age, everybody's gonna fall at some point. And for me, I just gotta be a catcher. I gotta be able to catch you at that moment. You know what I mean? That's when you gotta be there for them guys. Because if you don't catch somebody when they down, you're not gonna get them back.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
I ain't gonna blow it.
I ain't gonna mess you up right now. I'm gonna let you float though. You just gonna lose him at that time. So it's more of make sure. I just consider myself a catcher. If somebody's gonna fall, you got to make sure you catch them, because everybody's light goes on at a different time. Just like their body matures at different times. Everybody's ready to lift, ready to play. Not everybody comes in as a freshman ready to play. Mm-hmm. You know, so it just takes everybody a little bit of time, and everybody's light comes on at a different time. But if they fall, you just gotta be able to catch them. And once you do, the sky be the limit from there. I always want my guys to feel like they are letting me down when they mess up. Not that they just, you know, they just disappointed. Mm-hmm. And when you get to that point, that's when it's, the boys are ready to go, you know?
Mm-hmm. Man, I heard some great stuff, man. And man, I appreciate you just taking the time out and joshing with us and giving us some great, great input, man, because you touched on a lot of things, and believe it or not, you know, you as a coach, you're doing some counseling techniques, you know, that you just, you probably just don't have the formal term for them, but they're very, mm-hmm. very powerful. I've heard some motivational interviewing in there, you know, I heard some mindfulness in there, you know, I heard a lot of that stuff, man, and so I just kind of, you know, I want to applaud you guys to keep doing that, man, because that's going to make your campus, you know, safe. That's going to make, that's going to change the culture that you're talking about, because we need that. And the more you guys are touching coaches, teachers, you know, execs, managers, you guys are touching these people, not just student athletes, people, multiple people every single day, man. And the more people who are in leadership positions like yourself, who have that same outlook, have the same mindset, and then going ahead and applying it, mm-hmm. that's going to help us change our culture. And I said, you know, I think I'll be on Earth long enough to see that change, that monumental change. But it's going to take more folks like yourself, man, to continue to help change this piece about, you know, just our self awareness, our self worth, mm-hmm. and our mental health in general. Yeah. Man. So I appreciate you. You being here and coming out and sharing with us.
Hey, thanks for having me. I appreciate that. What's
up? Got a plug, any plug, small business, your own business, anything you got going on. Man, listen, don't say nothing about that. He want to wear that all day, every day. And I'm tired of, I'm about to put it in the contract. I don't want to see that no more.
I got a year with the boy, so you know.
I told you.
You know what I mean? I got a year with them.
Yeah, well, you're a Panther, though. You're a Panther. Yeah,
that's real. I am, though.
Yeah, though. Okay.
For 1 year. How you feel about that Super Bowl?
I'm still hurting. I'm still hurting. Man, he went off. I'm still hurting. I was broken down.
500 mil. Ooh, 10 years.
That's a crazy number.
But the crazy thing about it is he's 24 years old. That's the crazy number. He can see all of
another one.
I love it.
He can see all
of it. It might be cheaper to keep him on that. You know, because if he go ham and have to re-up, it couldn't.
And the word was that was kind of in the discussion of to do it that long.
Lock him in here now, yeah.
So you can kind of keep him, bring people in and not be strapped. Well, man, what's up, man? I appreciate you, man, just giving us your time, bro.
Great conversation.
Adding value to Blow the Whistle. We got a lot going on, man.
Conversation.
Don't want people to know that, you know, household names, the people you done played on the video game, they think just like you. We all think alike. We all deal with the same challenges mentally.
Yeah.
And go with the same coping skills and exercises and ways to get over these things, man, and prevail and be victors in our pain and finally, you know, how to find places of peace. And like I said, just big ups to you guys. If you learned that on your own, or if somebody trains you that way for the way you guys are conducting business for those kids, man, because that's big in their mental health. Just like you say, the open door policy is just the constant text messages, you know, just the being aware of different, you know, behavior, you know, routines and whatnot, man. That's just big, man. And I, those boys, man, I tell you guys, thank you, but shoot, I bet, you know, they go through a crisis and you guys are there, they're able to go through the tools that you guys have for them. I bet they're very much appreciative. So just as, you know, just as therapists ourselves, man, in that field, man, we're appreciative of having people like yourself doing that thing, man. I just say, keep it up, man. You know, for me, It's much love. It's been a daggone boy. Next year be 20 years, dog. Wow. 20 years I don't know you. 20 years. So, man, I appreciate the friendship, man. Much love, bro. And, you know, I'm going to be a UCLA Bruin to the day I die.
There you go.
Yeah, man. I appreciate it, Mr. Foster, for dropping through, man, blowing the whistle, raising awareness here. That's what we do as therapists in this mental health profession. That's what we're trying to do over here. We raising awareness through our own special platform. We blowing the whistle on it. So, again, I appreciate it, definitely. You know, because it's San Fran all day. You're still San Fran in my book. So, I definitely appreciate it, man, for stopping through, man, and chopping it up with us. I definitely love this conversation. It's much needed.
Yeah.
We need to have this regular conversations right here. And that's what we do here. We keep it raw.
Keep it raw. Blow the whistle, ladies and gentlemen. DeShaun Foster, man.
Yes, sir.
Check him out. Check out the team. Back 10. We have a season. Good luck, Coach.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thanks for having me, guys.
All right. Y'all be easy.